2016 is a little deceiving on paper. And again, I won't spend too long on it, but if you look at like the total heat accumulation in 2016 for Washington State and compare it to other warmer years like 14, 15, it looks like the heat accumulation is comparable, but it's a little deceiving because, like Mr. Bob Betz likes to say, it's not just about total accumulation, it's about distribution, kind of how you get your heat, right? And so what makes 16 unusual is it was the earliest bud break we'd ever seen at that point in time. 18 actually broke that record. And May broke every record in Washington State. We were kind of holding onto our seats by the time we got to June 1 saying, whoa, we just had the earliest bud break we'd ever seen. Most highest accumulative nighttime temperature, highest daytime temperature, all these metrics you could look at in beginning of 2016. May just shattered every record. So we thought, this is going to be a really warm year, but it was very deceiving because the vintage was very front loaded. We saw way more heat early in the season and it kind of tapered off as the season went, like the middle months, like by the time you get in July, maybe the end of June, July, just barely into August, we were tracking almost like the long-term average, like a 2012. So things started slowing down a little bit then, slowing down as far as heat accumulation. I think the vines actually started picking up because it was so hot early that the vines shut down quite a bit early in the day. But point being, obviously you taste all over the world and you probably, I do believe you speak French, but the French have a saying, which is August makes the must. And in maybe we could say September makes the must, right? Because, and Brennan will say this, he said this to me before, which is, you know, don't ask me about the vintage in May, ask me about the vintage in, you know, the end of September, because oftentimes that last ripening period, that 4, 5, 6 week period can really kind of shape the character of the vintage, particularly with Cabernet Sauvignon. And really that final period in Washington State in 2016, it was well below long-term average. I like to say it was pretty cool for a Washington vintage. It wasn't as cool as 2010, 2011 finish because we had all that heat in the beginning, like total heat accumulation, but it was below the long-term average. We didn't have a lot of heat and the fruit came into the winery pretty cool. And the skins in 2016 on Cabernet Sauvignon, and I tasted them all over Washington from Walla Walla, Yakima Valley, Horse Heavens, Wallouk Slope. I was all over tasting. And they were thin skins. The phenolics like the tannin, anthocyanin, the levels were a little lower. And I'm not saying that's good or bad, but the 2016s, from my perspective, they have a certain texture to them, early drinkability that I think is really attractive. It kind of maybe a little bit of contrast to some of the other bigger vintages with bigger shoulders. I don't know if that's been your experience with this.
That makes sense. 17 certainly seems bigger, but maybe a slightly less defined. And it doesn't quite have but 17 doesn't have the opulence of the 15. So does that make sense?
It makes a lot of sense. 15 was a bit of a roller coaster ride. We had some big heat in 15. We realized some pretty big, you know, post 100 degree days, like stretches of them in 15. And in 17, we had been predicted to hit days like that, but they never materialized. I don't know if Brennan or anybody else had mentioned it, but we had a smoke layer come in during.
He mentioned that.
Yeah, it would have been. There was about 3, 8, 9 day stretches in August and then into September where this sounds ridiculous, but we were predicted to hit 108 on near Benton City, Red Mountain. We were supposed to hit like 107 down in the Horse Heaven Hills near the river, and I feel bad in a way because I know a lot of people suffered from the smoke, like up in north of us and British Columbia and down in the Columbia Gorge, but it actually saved our butt. It really buffered us from that big heat that we never realized it. So instead of hitting 107, 108, you know, those days we hit 101, and you obviously know the difference between hitting 101 and 107 is there's an ocean of difference.
Why is Cabernet Sauvignon not better known in Washington compared to, say, Merlot or Syrah when you make such beautiful balanced wines?
That's a good question. That is a good question. I think you might have said something about that when you visited a couple seasons ago, because I think when you showed up, you were thinking more about other grapes, Malbec, which is amazing here, of course, we know that, and Syrah and grapes like that. But it is, I think you have Cocida Creek that kind of gets some attention outside of our local area with Cabernet, but there's not a lot of producers that are quite, I don't know. I mean, we're Washington State. I love living here, working here. It's exciting because we do have a lot of the world still yet to conquer and show our wines. But that's a good question. I'm not exactly sure why that is, but I hope we can change it. I think we get a lot of questions about that. People will ask Bob a lot, or when he's in interviews, and they'll say, hey, what's the future of Washington State? What is it going to be known for? What grape are we going to stand on? And he's always going to say Cabernet Sauvignon. So, yeah. But
keep on doing it. So it's like, they're very beautiful and different than California, have a whole different sensibility to it. And so I think that that's really cool.
Thank you. Yeah. And I think if you think about Cabernet Sauvignon, where it's grown, I mean, the most famous places for good reason, you think of Bordeaux, you think of Napa. Washington's a very different climate to grow Cabernet Sauvignon in. I mean, Napa, of course, you have that Mediterranean, classified as Mediterranean climate, where you have this very warm nights and warm days. And then Bordeaux, with its proximity to the ocean, which these things obviously know, I'm just pointing it out, it's maritime influence. Well, Washington State's inland continental, with the kind of people like to say larger diurnal shift, which is true, higher daytime temps and cooler nights. So it's kind of different. I like to think it's different for a reason, because it's a different climate. You don't find Cabernet Sauvignon growing in an inland continental climate too often. So, maybe that is part of it. Last week I did a vineyard run, and I hit most of the Yakima Valley, and I took notes, because I especially the growers that have been doing it a long time, I really like to pick their brain and say, hey, how did you see the vintage, the 2018 vintage? Because I have my own ideas about it, kind of where my vantage point was on it. And so I kind of collected a lot of data from growers. So 2018 was, I mean, you could just, as a winemaker grower, by the time we got to the end of the season, I have to assume that in our little world, it must have been the Southern Rhone felt like in 2016, where the grapes tasted just like otherworldly, and the cuvées and the fermentations just tasted like nothing I'd ever seen. And doesn't mean that's always going to be good, but like the colors were just on fire. I think there was just a lot of buzz in Woodinville. I mean, that's where we make wine, and Walla Walla, I'm sure as well. But anyhow, what kind of led us to that point in 2018? I was talking with Mike Sauer again on my trip last week at Red Willow Vineyard. He takes meticulous notes during the harvest season. And so I kind of wanted to just capture all that I could from him, especially when it was still a little fresh in his mind. And we had a very dry winter. It did not get particularly cold. I want to say he said 11 degrees Fahrenheit was the coldest it got out at Red Willow, which is a pretty mild winter. And we had kind of a almost an average bud break time in 2018. But what made it a little different is this is going to sound strange because people don't usually talk about it, but despite the fact that most of Washington State is on drip irrigation, hydric stress is still actually a pretty big deal for us, because just because we can use drip irrigation to give vines water doesn't mean that if we're if we're low on brown water, ground moisture, we're still going to feel hydric stress like Burgundy or Bordeaux or someplace like that. We might not suffer from it as much, but we will certainly feel it. We'll see it in the vines. The canopies will be lighter. And that is exactly the case in 2018. We went in with having a very dry winter, mild winter that we had bud break about, like I said, about a normal time period. And it was kind of a, it was kind of the opposite of 2016, where it was kind of a steady climb, where it started out kind of cool, got warmer. And then toward, especially Mike showed me his notes of, like July 15 through August 31, we had some pretty big heat in there. It wasn't like 2015 where we were breaking 100 degrees, but we did have a lot of stuff get up 97, 98 Fahrenheit. And again, just to give you like the unfiltered deal on Washington 2018, a lot of, I think, picking decisions, not just in Washington, but Oregon as well, were based on, we started getting a little bit of dehydration early in the season. And I think for a lot of us, no matter what part of the world you're making wine in, that's kind of a signal saying, hey, we're going to lose some freshness in the wines. And so strangely, I mean, I think you've probably heard people talking about all kinds of different metrics that they consider when they're trying to decide when to pick grapes. But that was something that we certainly went up against in Washington State, whether you're talking about Cabernet, Merlot, Syrah. But again, almost the opposite of 16, where we started with the slow burn kind of built up in that last, I guess, the 6 weeks, mid-July through August, the last day of August, it was pretty hot. And then September and October cruised. We cooled down, not dissimilar to 2018. And I think that's what got everybody excited, is we had already had a pretty uneventful season for the most part. In 2018, we had a lot of warmth in that 6 week period. So we had sugar accumulation getting there. Our acidities were already starting to get down there, and then it cooled down. So whenever you have a vintage like that in Washington State, I think you get to see a lot of stylistic diversity, because you could be somebody like, I don't know, Betz family, and we're trying to pick a little bit on the earlier side of the spectrum. Maybe we're trying to pick Cabernet, you know, September 20th. And then you could have some folks that maybe want to pick out October 20th, like Cool Cedar Creek. And I think everybody can kind of get in where they want to fit in that pick schedule, because the weather's good, it's cool, things are not moving too quickly, Brix is not climbing too quickly. So 2018 did kind of team up to be a pretty special vintage.
Yeah. And that gave you a chance to make wines that are ripe, but at the same time have a lovely freshness and are not dominated just by pure fruit character. They can really tell, they can tell where they're from. Fantastic.
Thank you.